Who, oh Lord, could save themselves? Their own soul could heal. Our shame was deeper than the sea. Your grace is deeper still.
Together as the people of God and part of our family here, we from St. Andrew's Church in Broadfields, with you at home, you on social media, we welcome you warmly to this fellowship. Today is the fifth Sunday in Lent, and we are going to be looking at God's grace and mercy through Psalm 16. And so let us pray. Lord, we praise you that you call us together. You have said wherever we call upon your name, you will be with us, and that you are among us. And so cleanse our hearts and our minds and use us, this ministry, to bring peace, goodness and blessing to those involved today. And I pray that wherever each person may be, your love will descend upon them, that they will feel your presence, and that you will speak to us, Lord, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Once again, welcome. And I know there are many of our members and friends all over who may be listening either through WhatsApp later on today or YouTube also. But for you who are live with us, it's such a privilege that we can come before the presence of God. Those of you who want to follow our service, you may have some of our service orders with you, and you can join with me in the West in Bold then. So this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And so we are together here in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to receive God's holy word today, and to pray for the needs of the world. During our service, we will ask for God's forgiveness, and we will pray that His Spirit will be with us to empower us so that we can give ourselves to His service in this time of crisis. But first, my brothers and sisters, let us come before God in humility and tell Him our personal thoughts, our deeds, the actions, the things that we fail to do, and ask Him, the God of mercy, to forgive us and grant us strength and wisdom. The Apostle John wrote, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is a faithful and a just God who is happy and willing to forgive us and to cleanse us from all that is not right, that we might have a brighter future." And so let's bring our prayer of confession now together as I lead you in saying, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct how we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in His image to the praise and glory of His name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The special prayer for the day. Most merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in Him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of His victory, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who's alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now have our reading, which will be from Psalm 16. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my God. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the godly who are in the land, they are the noble people in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out their libations of blood or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with your joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. And so, friends, we are living at times where there's so many alternatives to God in our world. In fact, the fact of the great human ingenuity and accumulated treasures of learning, technological advances, and if you like, the social media, there is so much that appear to nullify the need of the otherworldly realities, the reality of a creator and a loving God who cares for us. And at times it makes people ask that question, where does the Christian faith stand in the face of what is happening in our world? For while the story of human achievements have sometimes made the memory of God's saving works almost vague and mysterious, we together today can learn the real faith of the psalmist who prays, "Keep me safe, O God. Apart from you, there is no good." In the midst of what is happening around us, this grave danger around us, where do Christians stand? What is our faith? What is our hope for the future? Psalm 16 is often called a prayer song. Today, the writer of this psalm declares his faith and hope and calls us to do the same. And so here we go. From, you know, verse 1 of the psalm, we see the psalmist declaring his faith and telling us what this faith is all about. He begins by praying for protection, a testimony of his faith. And then he concludes by a declaration of his confidence and the future hope that he has. This faith, then, is the faith that is founded in this God alone. Now, throughout this psalm, what we find is that the psalmist uses different images to tell us about how good God is. God is good in all things and he brings joy. He's also allocated his portion and his true inheritance from verse 5 to 6. God is his only counselor, verse 7. He is the sure protection from physical and mortal danger, verse 1, verse 8, verse 10. Therefore, he will not be shaken. And finally, God is the one who guides his life now in this world and forevermore, meaning beyond his death. And so this is the God whom I am encouraging you to focus your thoughts on, despite our circumstances and all that is happening in the world. And so here we go as we look at the psalm very closely. In verse 1 and 2, having found refuge in God, the psalmist also knows that his greatest good is in God. He has flirted with the world. He has tasted the alternatives in the world. He has tasted everything that the world will offer him and has rejected them and turned to God. Indeed, there is nothing good apart from God, verse 2. There is no ideology, there is no security, there is no satisfaction, and there is no fulfillment apart from God. Delighting in God then, he will also delight in the people of God, those he calls holy, the saints of God. He will not be in company with the people who do not believe in God. He indeed says that they will suffer and suffer more. He says he will not pour the libation for them he will not associate with them, neither will he talk about them, mention their names on his list. But what has God done for this psalmist that he has so much confidence in him? And this is what he goes on to tell us in verse 5 and 6. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. And therefore, I have a delightful inheritance. It's almost an image of a host who is welcoming somebody at a feast. God is our host who welcomes his people at a great feast. God has assigned his portion and his cup. This is almost like a physical food. The food to eat and the cup to drink to satisfy his hunger and to quench his thirst. That is, his physical sustenance in terms of food rather than land. God is our provider, and therefore, this psalmist will continue to trust in him. But it's not only providing physical food for him to eat alone, but God has also given him a delightful inheritance. Now, what kind of inheritance is he speaking about here? Well, in the Old Testament, when it came to the time for the Levites, as they apportioned the land for them, and like the Levites, and they were not apportioning any land at all, because God said that he himself was their Lord, their inheritance. Their inheritance wasn't a material possession, but it was the experience of their closeness in the presence of God. It was the experience of their protection and their mercy which they received from God. The true possession of the believer is not to exist and live in the presence of worldly security, but in the presence of God under all circumstances. He will go on to tell us that the Lord is also his counselor, verse 7. And in the light of this trusting relationship, he declares, you are my counselor. Counselor indeed, which means that God draws near and speaks to him and teaches him in the stillness of the night. He dwells in his intimate relationship and will not be shaken by the events of the world, in verse 8. His closeness to God is not limited to single provision, but it also includes his security. His present faith brings future hope, future security, when we move on to verse 9. And so he can rejoice because he is convinced that when he dies, his body will be rest secure with the Lord. The psalmist wrote about the victory of death and fullness of life in verse 8, and the joy in the presence of God, which will be finally fulfilled in his time. But if he was convinced that God would look after him, his physical body, even beyond death, then let me tell you one thing that is special to us Christians. For Christians, it's get better, for we have died with Christ. And the worst, it's over. And since we have been raised with him also, we can live in that confidence that God has already saved us from what might destroy each one of us, whether it's illness or trials and tribulation. And so throughout the many dangers of this world, even in the midst of this viral infection of COVID-19, God remains our constant protector. He is our refuge. Because of God's goodness then, he will not delight in people who have exchanged the true living God for other gods. He will neither offer any affiliations and associations with them, because that will be incompatible with his wholehearted devotion to God, who has been his security, and God, who has been his provider. And so this morning, I just want us to learn from the psalmist. He has tasted this world. He knows the alternatives out there, but he believes that God is in control. God is our provider. God is our future security. He has conquered death. And we, in the light of Christ's resurrection, will live in a close relationship with him now, rejoicing in his goodness of his provision for us, his inheritance that he has given us. We will rejoice in the face what he has done in Christ, and be assured that because Christ is risen and has won victory over death, we too, whether we are alive or we are dead, will rest in him alone. He is our rescue. He is our provider. He is our God, our rock, our salvation. And we will put our faith solely in him. Amen. And so we have a God who is a faithful God, the God who is our protector, the God who is our refuge. And so let us come before him as we offer ourselves and this world, our community, to this God who is loving, all powerful, all compassionate, who is able to do all things. And so we pray now, offering our lives before God. We pray that he will deepen our faith, that we may know his power to save is above all things. We pray that we will not only put our faith in the things around us, and that although the circumstance might be grave, and that we may worry, we have a God who's able to rise above all the situation and bring hope, bring healing to us, to our families, and to our land. And so in this context, we pray for people who are victims of this COVID-19, those in our communities, our own loved ones. We pray God's hand upon them to revive and to restore them in the name of Jesus. We pray for those in hospitals in grave danger of death. Father, you are able to do all things. We pray that your presence will transform their situations now, that through the work of professional doctors and nurses and other staff of the NHS, their situation will be reversed and that good health will be restored in Jesus' name. And our Lord, we just thank you for your mercy and pray for all vulnerable people, the elderly, even young people, people with ailments. Lord, you are above all the searches of this COVID-19. Your power can restrict all things. And so we pray that you will protect them. You will put a ring of fence upon their lives, around them, that they will survive, be in good health, and live a fulfilled life. That all of us, our friends, our families, our loved ones, will be protected by the deep love of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Lord, we pray particularly for those whom we know who have been infected with this illness once again. Show yourself to them, Lord. And now we bring our government, the royal family, Prime Minister and his cabinet, all those who are involved in decision making, both national level and at local level, community groups, volunteering groups, people who are offering themselves for the service of others. We thank you for them and we pray your love to surround them, that you, Lord, will protect and you will heal and restore. Grant us stronger DNA, stronger opposition, and stronger will to stand up against this illness. And as even they lead and as they minister and as they serve this community, may they have compassion, thinking of vulnerable people in all circumstances. We pray for practical support now, Lord, in our communities, in our neighborhood. Point us to the right places where we can help one another. Give us the resources. Give us the courage. You took a risk for all of us. Help us to take risks for each other and serve our communities well. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so let us bring our prayers together. Praying the prayer that Jesus taught us with confidence. We pray the traditional version of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light upon our paths, and a strength to our lives. So take us and use us to love and serve all people in the power of your Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So just about before we just come to the end of this service, it's been a great privilege to worship with you today. We are thinking of launching a new Zoom video service next week around probably 11:30. We will specify the time so that we can have an interactive service. But for those of you who join us on Facebook, those who will join us later on WhatsApp, it's been a great pleasure, and we wish God's blessing upon you. Let us receive God's blessing. The love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill our hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those whom you love, now and always. Amen. So brothers and sisters, listen to God's instructions, his promptings to you. Listen to government instructions. Stay home. Keep safe. God bless. Thank you.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no troubles. but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, and if my God is with me,
yes, I can see a light that is coming.